How would you begin designing an electrical power system? There are many things to consider, and the topic can be pretty complicated. But a solid understanding of the basics, simple concepts like volts, amps, watts, and watt hours, will get you pretty far. If you know these fundamental set of terms, then you can begin to describe almost any system. In this video, we'll approach these basic terms from a design perspective and establish the practical link to how they can be used as building blocks when designing real-world power systems. In a follow-up video, we'll discuss other crucial design considerations like inductive and capacitive loading, nonlinear loads, reactive power, and power factor. But for the remainder of this video, we'll keep it as simple as possible and concentrate on only the basics that will help lead into more advanced topics. First, let's start off with two key terms that'll help frame the rest of the discussion: load and source. Simply put, the load is what we want to be able to power on, and the source is what helps provide the energy needed to power it on. There are a couple of points we can intuit from this relation between load and source using examples from daily life. First, certain loads require certain sources. You know you wouldn't power your refrigerator with batteries, and going the other way, you wouldn't power a flashlight with a wall outlet. Second, different loads use different amounts of power. A washer-dryer set uses significantly more power than your phone charger. In fact, if you check the plugs, they're actually different because they have different power requirements. And third, a given source only has so much capacity. Your phone will last a while when you use it normally, but if you accidentally leave the flashlight on, then the battery will drain a lot faster and it wouldn't last nearly as long. Volts, amps, watts, and watt hours are all terms that help describe these relations in more detail, and they're key to designing any power system, be it an electronic circuit, all the way up to an entire city's electrical infrastructure. Volts, which is the unit for voltage, is commonly described as electrical pressure. Just like water pressure is what makes water flow, voltage is needed to drive electricity throughout a circuit to a load. Practically all power systems will need something to provide this voltage, its source. This could be a generator, solar panels, or something else. The voltage level that the source needs to provide depends on the loads. If there isn't enough voltage, the load won't function correctly. And if there's too much voltage, then there's a risk of damage. Transformers are key pieces of equipment that help adjust this voltage level to whatever it needs to be. While technically a load can be designed to need any arbitrary voltage, practically everything follows standard voltage conventions. Transformers in the United States define five main commonly available output levels: 120 volts, 208, 240, 277, and 480, and the standard bins could be different elsewhere. From a design aspect, this is to say that the level of voltage in a system dictates what kinds of loads the system is suitable for. Along with needing a certain operating voltage, a load will also use a certain amount of amps, or current, in order to actively run. Backing up to the water analogy, it doesn't matter how much water pressure you have if there's no water flowing to actually do anything with. Water flow here is current in our electrical system. Let's say I have a power strip plugged into a kitchen outlet. Without a load attached, there's no current flowing even though there's voltage available at each outlet. If I plug in a toaster and turn it on, it'll draw about 10 amps. I could also plug in a blender that draws 12 amps and use it at the same time as the toaster. Since current is additive for parallel loads, then the total draw from the power strip is 22 amps, which could damage power strip cables or trip an upstream breaker. This is also why it isn't a good idea to daisy chain power strips. If you end up plugging in a couple more appliances, this could make the problem a whole lot worse. The next question is, can the source support the loads? Just like a load requires a certain amount of current to run, a source can only supply so much current before risking damage. However, sizing your supply isn't as simple as just comparing currents. Instead, the best way to check for this is to look at power ratings, which is described by watts. Watts, in its most simplistic form, is equal to volts times amps. It's useful because often a power system will have multiple voltage levels available simultaneously, and power lets us compare everything together directly. A dryer might require 240 volts and 20 amps, and a refrigerator could use 120 volts and 5 amps. But even if the dryer drew the same amount of current as the refrigerator, the power it uses is still different due to the voltage difference. The dryer uses 240 volts times 20 amps, which equals 4,800 watts or 4.8 kilowatts, and the refrigerator uses 120 volts times 5 amps, which equals 600 watts. Knowing about how much power an entire home may use is helpful information for utility companies to allocate power in an area. If they were to oversize transformers, for example, there would be wasted capacity. But if they undersize them, then you wouldn't be able to power on many things in your home without overworking and damaging the transformer. Sometimes, power, in watts, is confused with energy, in watt hours. Power is a rate, or how much work is being done at any given moment. To count how much energy is used, you need to know the amount of power as well as how long the work was being done for. Then simply multiply the two. Watts times hours gives watt hours. If I have a 75 watt light bulb and turn it on, every second that it's shining, it's doing 75 watts worth of work. To know the total energy used in 2 hours of it being on, I can just multiply 75 watts by 2 hours and get 150 watt hours. More usefully, if I have a 30 kilowatt hour battery bank and the utility goes out, if my average rate of power consumption is 10 kilowatts for my home, then I know I can run off that bank as backup power for 3 hours. This is the way the utility knows how much to charge its customers. For reference, they usually bill 10 to 20 cents per kilowatt hour, so energy usage can really start to add up as cost. The previous examples we used were with single-phase power in a residential setting, but most larger-scale power systems, like in industrial and commercial applications, will require three-phase power. If you want to brush up on the basics of single-phase versus three-phase, you can watch this video here. Now let's bring it all together and design a system. The goal is to power three pre-chosen 30 horsepower motors. The nameplate data for the motors says that they draw 80 amps at 208 volts or 35 amps at 480 volts to feed chillers in a commercial facility. Knowing this, we would first size the feeder cables to accommodate the current at the selected voltage for all three motors. In most applications, you would size the upstream breaker to at least 125% of the expected current. In our case, running at 208 volts, the feeder would need to be sized at 300 amps capacity per phase, or if running at 480 volts, about 150 amps per phase. One factor in deciding if you want to run at 208 or 480 volts would be how far away your motors are from the transformer. If there's a run of 500 feet, voltage drop across the line becomes the concern at 208 volts, since the higher current would result in more losses. Using a higher voltage like 480 volts has two advantages. First, it saves money during installation because the cost of copper cabling for a 150 amp circuit is significantly less than for a 300 amp circuit. And second, there are less kilowatt losses, which over time can help reduce your power consumption. Now it's time to talk about energy and money. If each motor uses about 24 kilowatts and is running on average 120 hours a month, and the local utility price per kilowatt hour is 13 cents, then the energy used per month for all three motors can be calculated by three motors times 24 kilowatts, which is the power draw of each motor, times 120 hours, which is the runtime per month, equals 8,640 kilowatt hours. Then multiplying by 13 cents per kilowatt hour, which is the utility cost, gives $1,123 per month. You can imagine why it's so important for industrial facilities, which have many more and much heavier loads, to find ways to use less energy to save money. One great way to save energy when running motors is by using variable frequency drives, which you can learn more about in this video. And congratulations, that's our little power system. This would just be one branch of a larger system, but all the concepts extend to all levels of design. Moving forward, we can build off these design calculations and start taking into account other factors like reactive power and power factor, which are also key points to consider. To summarize, we related basic electrical terms you may have learned in school to their practical use in designing and analyzing real power systems. Volts are about what's being used, amps are about how much is being used, watts are about sizing what is used, and watt hours are about how much it costs to use. To learn more about power systems and what goes into designing them, contact us or your local Eaton representative to schedule a visit to one of Eaton's Power Systems Experience Centers today.